Good morning. And welcome to worship on this second Sunday of Pentecost. And happy Father's Day to those both here on earth and in heaven. And earlier today in our prayer before we came out, we of course ask for thanks to our Heavenly Father for the days we've been given and the days we can gather together in worship. And one of those, and somehow in my head it struck that I wanted to share with you, is that saying the prayer is like, God, we need more fathers, people to lead and care and create and to support. So that was part of our prayer this morning. Getting ready for service, and I wanted to share that with you today. Announcements coming up on the 30th of June. Our students will recital here at Emanuel. That is at 6 p.m. here in the sanctuary. A little different format, a little different time. Usually we go after a service, and we felt it would be a little cooler than all the students. But at the same time, again, you all are invited. There is no charge for our recital. We have students reciting, like I said, not this Thursday, the Thursday after. Speaking of this week coming up, if you're trying to get a hold of me, I apologize. I am in class for the next week. I'll be taking classes in Lutheran heritage and Lutheran mission for leadership. Message, however, I will respond as soon as I can. We go on a break or something of that nature. I did bring my class books to go through service room because it always thinks all the help I can get. These ones are two very difficult ones. Are there any announcements? Sorry?
Council meeting. Council meeting.
Oh, tomorrow night at 6, the council does meet, and they'll be meeting here at all. Any other announcements? Thank you, Bill. Yes, Linda.
What shrubbery and the fire, is there any movement on that?
Not to my knowledge, other than I noticed that they put new mulch down around, right? Honestly, that's a council question. I don't have the answer to that.
At this point, as far as I know, regarding that, they're waiting for the insurance adjuster. And because there really was, fortunately, very, very little damage to the church, the insurance adjuster kind of put logo on his priority list. If the church had been incinerated entirely, yeah, he'd be there the next day or the same morning.
So we're waiting on the adjuster to do
yeah.
Things. Yeah. If there are no other announcements, let us prepare for worship.
Thank you.
Please stand. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light, and our salvation. Amen. Let us come into the light, the revealing light of God. God of grace and glory, you have brought us through the night of sin into the light of Jesus' resurrection. Yet our lives are still shadowed by sin. Make us alive in Christ our Father. Make us new as you make all things new. Rescue us from evil and deliver us from sin. Renew us in grace and restore us to living in our holiness. Through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Rejoice with all creation around God's throne. The light of the risen Christ puts to flight all evil deeds, washes away sin, restores innocence to the fallen, casts out hate, brings peace, and humbles earthly pride. Jesus Christ loves you and frees you from your sins by his blood. To him be the glory and dominion forever and ever. Our opening hymn today is We Are Called. It's number 720.
Thank you.
south shore, a man from the city who had demons met him. For a long time he had not worn any clothes, and he did not live in a house but in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell down before him, shouting, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me." For Jesus had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man. For many times it had seized him. He was kept under guard and bound with chains and shackles, but he would break the bonds and be driven by the demon into the wild. Jesus then asked him, "What is your name?" He said, "Legion," for many demons had entered him. They begged him not to order them to go back into the wilderness. Now there on the hillside, a large herd of swine was feeding, and the demons begged Jesus to let them . So Jesus gave them permission. Then the demons came out of the man and entered the swine, and the herd sent down the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. When the swineherd saw what had happened, they ran off and told it in the city and in the country. Then people came out to see what had happened, and when they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. It became brighter. Those who had seen it told them how the one who had been possessed by demons had been healed. Then the whole throng of people in the surrounding region of the Gerasene asked Jesus to leave them, for they were seized with great fear. So Jesus got into the boat and returned. The man from whom the demons had gone out begged that he might be with him. But Jesus sent him away, saying, "Return to your house and declare how much God has done for you." And so the man went away, proclaiming throughout the city how much Jesus had done for him. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Jesus stepped out on shore. A man from the city who had demons met him. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell down before him, shouting, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God?" This past week, as I pondered and reflected on this week's gospel, I'm reminded of another passage found in Matthew, which myself, as a seminarian candidate, I hear frequently to reflect on and to find direction on this call. In chapter 13 of Matthew, the 57th verse, it's written, "And they took offense to him. But Jesus said to them, 'Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown and into their own house.'" It's what we have in common with the man Jesus healed in today's gospel. Our past, our sins, are sometimes called us those demons. And it's many times a reason a pastor or a seminarian is not assigned to their hometown. Jesus' words ring through in Matthew as loudly as the past of errors and behaviors which could be harmful, hurtful to an incoming pastor or congregation. Now, we here as Lutherans in Bradford, we don't know or we don't share much testimony about ourselves and others outside of our world. It's pretty much a Pentecostal thing. You can see that. Let me stand up right up and tell you how Jesus took me from lowliness to holiness, from greed to grace. Not very well practiced that, am I? Sharing where God has brought us from and how he too can help us bring others is a critical part of our mission and message to the world. So, how we interact and respond within the world is very important. And acknowledging our demons, past or present, is difficult, but maybe necessary. Our homiletic preparation is the world in front of us. so about the, around that time, it's very messy. About that time, so very messy, very painful divorce. For years, if I could change my name and deny my life to them, I would. Went out weekends with friends, thinking that that's where I would find happiness and control of heart. I couldn't be satisfied with the job. I had several in a few years, 7 months to be exact, in a 2 year period. I wasn't your best choice to talk or hang out with in those times, changing friends and relationships like a carousel. Now don't be mistaken, yes, I knew who God was, and I felt a calling to serve the Lord and to serve a congregation as a youngster, but felt like God at that point in my life had lost or forgotten. Of course, He didn't. I certainly acted like I forgot Him, put Him away like a child's plaything, no longer keeping my interest. And sure, I attended church every Sunday, weekly to play or to sing, or to lead music, or just to do what I was supposed to do, and show up. The demons of alcohol and cigarettes, and fast friends, and faster times held me tight. And I'll tell you, many times on a Sunday morning, sitting in the pew, I felt like a hypocrite. Demons, you see, don't have to be big spirits that are causing people to act odd. Scary or looming from above, change your actions and cause some noticeable and some unnoticeable damage. Sometimes it seems we can choose our demons, self-imposed, or others that can be taught and can be affirmed. If I were to say at around 30 years old that I was starting the journey that I am on now, I wouldn't have allowed myself, if I were a selection committee or a church called. Those demons live in my past and are in the world, but even though they are many years removed from this walk and how I live today, very differently than then, usually, every so often, I will bump into someone who knew me then, or someone I heard, whether it be real or imagined, then. Forgiveness of my actions and asking for this is the gift that God gives. Living in the tombs of the first century would have been considered insane. This man, his demons exposed, was driven out to live in a grave and with pigs. If you think of the use of demons, the last good thing this man probably did was leave the city. And doesn't it show a little bit of strength this man had before Legion? The many demons that possessed him had gotten full control of him. Did he consciously leave Jacera, leaving wife and children, a home, a job, a heart, extended family and friends, to save them from himself? His reputation was being ruined by the sins and actions he had caused. The life he tried to spare his loved ones, knowing the demons were controlling him. So, you all are better off without him, as he could tell them. Go on, live good, save lives. Believe me, I understand that aspect of a man's life all too well. But even in desperation, even when the world seems far from God, that's when Jesus truly enters. He rolls up with his tomb. Remember, Jesus is a Jew today in Gentile land. Jerusalem, cross. Here he is, a Jew who could have looked down upon the Gentile, looked on me as lower class, not good at it, and certainly to look on and certainly not to talk. In our lives, we all reach one point or another when we cry out to Jesus, feeling the guilt in our lives and the hurt we might have caused, not turning the other cheek. Taking and using others for gain, lying and cheating and drinking and drugging and stealing and all kinds of sinful behavior. And we look up to the cross and say, what? What would you have me? What would you have of me, Jesus, Son of the God, Son of the Most High God?
Why are you here?
I'm getting what I deserve, a self-imposed hell on earth. What could you possibly want from me? Pretty even to be around me. Legion, we are fallen. For demons, sins, and a corrupt moral life, preventing you living. The desperation of knowing the loss that you caused in yourself. In others, all welled up out in the open. We can hide our demons from each other, I think we can, but with Jesus we can't hide. He knows our demons. He knows their name and their weight, and he should, because he carried them all to Calvary. When looking at the cross, realize what that means. What that sacrifice was for, and who it was for, we can truly heal within. We too can sit at his feet. We can be clothed by him in the garment of the kingdom and listen to him and be comforted by him. Being one who having resurrection to be healed from our sins, as only Jesus can do it. We don't know why the man asked to leave Jesus. When the townspeople upset about the swine and confused by the madman now saying, the man felt maybe a need of gratitude to serve Jesus by his side wherever he went. A new life, one away from family and where he was, a clean start, maybe going someplace where no one knew him was born. A chance to run away and be far away from that person he used to be. Aren't there times in our lives that we look back and wish we could throw away? I realize that putting away or erasing the past or going where no one knows you would be desirable, very easy. But we would miss something important, something that Jesus taught today, which, if lost, erasing the wonderful thing he has done, and our way to thank and praise him for this. Jesus many times in the gospel says, come, follow me. Yet in today's passage, Jesus tells the man, no, go home, return home, and show how much God has done for you. By the man returning to Gerasa and showing how Jesus changed his life, demons gone and a new life restored, in time showed him and shows us that a life can be changed, our own, by accepting Jesus and getting the demons off our life. This man becomes from demonic sinner to Christ's name, sins and demons removed. And this man set free, showing how when God through Jesus and the Holy Spirit intersecting in our lives, how we truly do go from low to whole, from forgotten to forgiven. There is an old saying that says, if you dig around in the past, all you do is get dirty. Yet to know what clean or dirty is in reference to our lives and souls shows the complete and utter change in our lives. Now, will I ever eliminate who I tried to be then in its memory, myself and others? Probably not. Can I stop the memory of those demons when they try to come back as they did this past week, reminding me of the past and stop who I am now? See, by living the gospel, by acting as a Christian, often, by coming to learn and to grow as a child of God should, to do so with a servant's and a child's heart, and giving a complete trust in Jesus, I one day may have new stories to glory. You see that guy did that? Ooh, he used to growl very loud today, but you know, you never know that now because he knows. I wonder if he would tell us how. Demons will still try us and try to drag us down. No stronger the faith, the harder the demons are going to try to be ready. Face it, we're sinners. That's the way it is. But in our sin, we stand forgiven. God loves us completely. Now fear your youth. Your sinful self in days and years past, in showing his unbounded, overflowing privilege. Because in doing so, you may save them. Finally, when the demons get bad, you view yourself slipping. There's one surefire pair of the words, something that was told many years ago. When the demons or Satan reminds you of your past, you can always remind him of his future. And out. Not perfect. one people of God, recited our Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, was crucified and died in the Spirit. He descended to heaven. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life of Christ. For all our prayers and those that are buried within our hearts.
Father, you try to promote it for me. Thank you for your sacrifice, Lord Jesus. The blood of Christ, the treasure.
Our son.